Hello and welcome to this presentation on reactive relational database connectivity using RTDBC. I am Maarten Smeets. I work as a software architect at Tamise Conclusion, located in Nieuwegein, and by Oracle acknowledged as a community expert. I've written quite a lot of blogs, which are quite popular, presented worldwide, written articles, well certified. I've experienced with many customers, and if you want to get in touch, please do. I'm going to show you results from performance tests, RTDBC versus JDBC. Well, performance tests, of course, are specific. I used specific hardware, specific version of libraries, specific implementations, etc., specific settings. So it will be very difficult to exactly reproduce the same results for you on your own systems. So if you want to know, for example, if your application will have better performance when using RTDBC, please try it out for yourself. Do your own implementation, do your own test, and then you will know for sure. Use these tests as an inspiration of what you could expect. So we are going to talk about relational database access from Java. And well, of course, we need to look at JDBC, right? Because JDBC is what everyone uses nowadays almost. To access relational databases. JDBC is quite old. It was introduced in JDK 1.1 in 1997. That was even before I was an adult. And it provides an API to access relational databases. You can see a small code example below. You use a driver to obtain a connection. You create a statement. You bind variables. You partial results, etc. Well, of course, you won't do this. You would use a framework nowadays, not directly use JDBC, but this is how the basic setup looks. Your Java application uses a JDBC API, but below that API, there can be different drivers, different accessing different databases. And the idea is that you become vendor independent. You can switch to another data relational database without having to change your application too much. If you've done it right. So you can switch from Oracle to Postgres to MySQL without having to change your application code. It's quite powerful. It's nicely decoupled. Of course, never directly use JDBC, right? Because we have frameworks which make a lot of the things you would otherwise manually do a lot easier. So how would does your regular JDBC stack look like for a service, for example? Well, you have your driver and your connection pool. Those are used by the Java Persistence API, JPA. JPA provides object relational mappings. You want to translate your database objects to Java classes, Java instances of those classes. You want an easy way to implement data access objects, transaction management. Usually JPA is not directly used in business logic, so you have a service layer to decouple that. And you can expose the logic by means of using a controller, for example. In this presentation, I'm going to specifically look at a Spring stack. Why? Because Spring has many components. Spring has blocking web frameworks like WebMVC, but also non-blocking web frameworks like WebFlux. I wanted to know if using a non-blocking relational database access driver would require me to use also a non-blocking web framework. So because Spring provides both, I can easily compare them. Spring also provides Spring Data JPA and Spring Data RTDBC, which also can nicely be compared and next to each other. Of course, as you can see in this picture, I mentioned Hibernate, Hickory Connection Pool. Well, those are the defaults for Spring Boot nowadays. Those are JDBC specific. So if we want to have an RTDBC implementation which is comparable to what we're currently using, then these components need alternatives. So one of the features of, for example, Spring Data JPA is object relational mapping. You have in your database, relational database, you have tables, primary keys and foreign keys. Select statements to query fetch data. And in your Java application, you usually use JPA annotations. You on your entities. And in this case, we have two tables. We have employees and departments. We have two entities, two entity classes. And the annotations specify the columns and the relations and the tables which are used. So this is nice. But we also want something above the entity level, because an entity is just a single thing, right? So repositories in Spring Data help you do operations over multiple entities. For example, to find an entity with a specific ID, to count entities. And the CRUD repository is an example which provides many operations out of the box, so you don't have to manually create mappings. Spring Data also provides query derivation based on interface method names, which is quite cool. If I create a method name count by department, my implementation will be generated based on the name of the method, which is quite cool. But this can quickly get complicated when your queries become more difficult. Find by last name, order by first name, ascending. Well, this is relatively easy, but you can see the method name already becomes really long. That's why you have can define named queries using JPQL, which is database independent, or you can use native SQL. Be very careful when using native SQL, because the SQL dialect used by different databases might differ, and you might get a create a vendor lock-in if your SQL is too specific for a specific database. So if you can use the predefined operations in the repositories, that's the way to go. Otherwise, query derivation, and if all else fails, define named queries, first using JPQL, and if that is not sufficient, use native SQL. A JDBC stack uses threads. If I do a database call, the thread is blocked. So if I call my database, database procedure, fetch data, the thread is waiting for a response, and during that time, it's waiting. Connections also consume threads. A connection pool has a specific number of connections, and if you if all the connections in the pool are busy and you ask for another one, you get more blocking, more waiting threads. So when we look inside the JVM, there's a link at the bottom for a blog of someone who did that. When you look inside the JVM, you see a lot of threads and a lot of blocked threads. And those are threads which are waiting for something. They're not like doing business logic, they are waiting. So important to know is that if you have many threads, only a small number of threads can be executed simultaneously. There's a limit to how many can be handled by your CPU at the same time. If there are more threads, the CPU might need to switch between them. And switching between threads, what is that? Well, that's saving state of the current thread, restoring the state of another thread, doing some logic in that thread, storing state of that thread, switching to another thread. You can imagine that's an expensive operation. And the more threads you use, the more context switches you will get, and the more CPU overhead you will have from that those context switches. So there's a CPU cost involved in using many threads. But there's also a memory cost. Reserved memory is virtual memory specific to the process. Committed memory cannot be used. It's actually mapped to RAM. On swap space, it cannot be used for other things. Reserved memory, because it's not specifically mapped yet, can be used. In Java 8, reserved and committed memory for a thread, has its own stack, is like 1 megabyte per thread. But in Java 11, the committed memory and reserved memory are not the same. So some of the memory which has not been committed yet can still be used for other things. So it's more efficient in memory usage. And of course, when creating threads, cleaning up threads, garbage collection plays an important role. And garbage collection algorithms evolve during time. So in newer Java versions, those garbage collection algorithms are usually more efficient. So you can help reduce the memory cost by going to newer Java versions, especially for moving from 8 to 11 is a big one. So, CPU overhead, memory overhead. And that results in, well, in chaos. It can result in chaos because you can get resource congestion. Your CPU can be busy with switching between threads, switching and switching and switching and switching and switching, and not getting any other work done, like actual business logic. Or your memory can create that, destroy thread, create thread, destroy thread, cleaning up thread, garbage collection, etc., etc. And eventually, that resource overhead becomes so much that your application won't be able to perform any business logic anymore. So that causes a challenge when concurrency increases at high scale. And also, if your database is slow, or if you just have a lot of data in your database and a query takes a long time, or if you have logic implemented in your database, like procedures, for example, the thread, which is used by JDBC, can be blocked for a long time. And if it's a really, really, really long time, it can become stuck. And then can sort of get, well, lost by the JVM. You can, there's a limit on the number of threads, which can be instantiated because of memory, of course. You can get thread starvation. So you can have like a lot and a lot of JDBC threads, which are all waiting for something. And then new incoming requests might not get available threads anymore. So incoming requests might not work anymore. So your application responsiveness could suffer. But luckily, of course, we're in a world where things improve, usually for the better. And so can we, because, well, there's RTDBC. RTDBC is fully non-blocking. So it does not use a thread per connection. It does not use a thread per JDBC operation. It has a fixed number of threads. And even at high concurrency, it uses those same threads to do all the work, which helps a lot with the CPU overhead and memory overhead, as you can imagine. So for example, on the right, you can see a small code example. You can start the transaction and do your thing and then end the transaction. Of course, just like with JDBC, don't ever do this. You have frameworks to help you with that. Or do we? This is RTDBC, it's new. We'll see in a bit. RTDBC also is an open standard. And there are already a lot of drivers available for most popular databases, MySQL, SQL Server, MariaDB, Postgres, Cloud Spanner, H2. I know the Oracle database driver is being worked on and is expected soon. I'm not sure when soon is, but soon. The DB2 driver is also a work in progress. I'm not sure when it's done. So what is the promise of RTDBC? What can we expect? Well, more efficient uses of resources like CPU and memory. And what that means in a cloud environment, cheaper. You can do more for less resources. Or with a fixed set of resources, yeah, you can do more work. Better application responsiveness, of course. At high concurrency, your application won't be switching and doing memory stuff, et cetera, et cetera, much less because it has a fixed number of threads. So if I start up my mobile phone and go to a web page, I will get a response instead of having to wait for some background database stuff to be completed. And of course, high concurrency, especially when working at web scale, large scale, many requests, we expect better efficiency and responsiveness. So now you know why we want to do RTDBC, but how do we do it? Well, first, I've shown you this image, right? It's Spring Data JPA, JDBC driver, JDBC specific. For RTDBC, we have an RTDBC specific stack. So with Spring Data RTDBC, we have RTDBC drivers and an RTDBC connection pool. And Spring Data RTDBC takes care of providing reactive repositories and object relational mapping. We try to keep the implementation minimal and simple. So it's not as extensive as JPA, So it does not have all the features, but the most important ones are there. So as I indicated, no JPA, no Hibernate, no Eclipse Link, no OpenJPA. If you're using Spring Data REST, if you don't know what it is, then you're probably not using it. But Spring Data REST allows you to annotate your repositories so your controller gets automatically generated. It's quite nice to use, but it's JPA specific, so it's not there for Spring Data RTDBC yet, not sure. And you cannot use JPA annotations, so you need to update your entities to use Spring Data annotations instead of JPA annotations. And some functionality is missing. For example, generating a schema from entities. You have to generate your schema another way. Also, some functionality might not be compatible with using reactive code. For example, lazy loading and caching right behind. Well, they're difficult to translate to a fully non-blocking stack. Spring Data RTDBC provides reactive repositories and reactive interfaces, Flux and Mono. You might know them from Webflux. So it integrates really nicely with Webflux. Spring Data JPA provides more blocking repositories, but additional features which we're used to in JPA. There is an alternative to R2DBC, which is being implemented in Hibernate Reactive. Quarkus also has an implementation. It's a Vertex Reactive client. You cannot easily compare the performance characteristics of R2DBC with, for example, the Vertex Reactive client, because the implementation differs. And there might somewhere under the hood be some blocking components. So you should be very careful when choosing a reactive driver and expecting performance benefits, because it might not be the case in every implementation. If you want to use RTDBC, it helps to switch to Webflux. We'll see in a bit when I will show you some results from performance tests. Of course, no Spring Data JPA, but Spring Data RTDBC and the driver and connection pool. Easy as that. Your entities, they look quite similarly. So it's not like an entire rewrite of your entities. It's just changing some annotations. But there are some things to notice here. For example, in RTDBC, you specify a table. Why? Because we don't have the generate schema from entities functionality. So it needs to know in which table the entities should be stored. You have no auto generation of IDs. There are solutions for that though, but you can look them up online. And of course, no Spring Data REST is possible. But generally, the entities annotations are quite similar. And of course, if you use a non-blocking REST controller like Spring Webflux, then the objects returned by the reactive repositories, which are Mono and Flux objects, they can directly be returned by your methods. So this is quite a nice fit. And then performance, because the promises of RTDBC are, well, they're quite nice. RTDBC promises more efficient resource usage, less overhead at high concurrency. So if we look inside the JVM, how does it look like? Well, a fixed number of threads, and the threads are actually doing something instead of just switching and having overhead and clearing memory. They're busy running, which is nice. But this is just a look inside the JVM. This is not actual response times or performance measures. So what did I do? I looked at WRK. It's an HTTP benchmarking tool. I also looked at Apache Bench, but Apache Bench uses threads, and threads, they don't scale well at high concurrency. WRK was able to provide much more load. And I compared Webflux with WebMVC and JDBC with RTDBC. And of course, in between Spring Data RTDBC and Spring Data JPA. And my backend was a Postgres database. I did simple GET requests to fetch data. First, I did some priming. I put the service on the load, so all the classes were loaded and connections were initialized. I was not so much interested in the startup time, but since the entire JPA part is not present in RTDBC, you get smaller jars and less memory usage, et cetera, et cetera. But yeah, I was not in this case directly interested in that. First some priming before the real tests. Also, I gave me more reproducible results. And I used dedicated resources because I was performing tests for my own laptop. I assigned specific CPU threads to the load generator, to the service, and to the database because I did not want them to be competing for that resource. WRK did not provide nice output, so I used some Python code in JupyterLab to like make it nice. And then I did some data processing using NumPy and Pandas. And I visualized them using Matplotlib, which gave me nice and reproducible graphs. So, data. Well, this is one of the graphs which illustrates nicely that the response times for RTDBC are a lot better than for JDBC and WebMVC and a completely non-blocking stack. Does almost the same as WebMVC together with RTDBC. But when both components are blocking, you get worse performance, worse response times. And when only using Webflux, it's still worse than using Webflux and RTDBC, but it's better than using a completely blocking stack. Response times. At different concurrencies. Throughput. How many requests could be processed at in a certain amount of time? Well, one of the things to notice is higher here is better. At start, you can see that WebMVC JDBC does best at low concurrency. But at higher concurrency, quickly, it becomes apparent that RTDBC does better and that Webflux also does better. Also, what you can see is that WebMVC and JDBC starts to perform worse in means of throughput when concurrency increases. Well, even when you're using one reactive component, the throughput stays stable, even at high concurrency. Predictable responsiveness, that's quite nice. Memory usage. I looked at memory usage per request. It was the process private memory used at the end of the test. Here you can see that at high concurrency, the higher the concurrency gets, the more WebMVC, JDBC, the more memory it uses per request. Best does a completely non-blocking stack. And even when using one reactive component, results at higher concurrency become predictable. CPU usage per request. Do we see an efficiency improvement in how much CPU is used? Well, with a completely blocking stack, WebMVC and JDBC, at low concurrency it does best, but at high concurrency, CPU usage per request starts to increase. When using RTDBC and WebMVC, when using a completely non-blocking stack, it gives the lowest CPU usage to process a single request at high concurrency. And the combination of Webflux and JDBC did not do so well in this test. Did not appear to be that efficient. It could be specific to my implementation, by the way. That's was mentioned in the disclaimer. So I also took a look at Quarkus, because Quarkus has JDBC. In Quarkus, you can use JDBC drivers, but also the Vertex Reactive Client. And I took a look at the throughput. Now, Quarkus with JDBC does best. Quarkus with Vertex, the reactive client, did not do so well. Well, with Spring Boot with RTDBC, we see a large improvement when using RTDBC. So that's the difference. So when switching to a reactive client, it depends on the framework, what the effect on your performance is. I also looked at RX Java and used it as a wrapper, reactive wrapper around JDBC, which did not give better performance than completely blocking stack. Probably because, I'll not go into detail. Response times. We see that Quarkus with lower is better. So Quarkus Vertex client did slightly worse than the Quarkus JDBC client driver. But with Spring Boot, it's the other way around. And RX Java did not do so well in this case. So to summarize the results of these tests, WebMVC and JDBC, best response times and throughput, but also best support and most features at low concurrency. Uses resources more efficiently. So if you're not like above 50 concurrent requests, please stick to WebMVC and JDBC because it's most efficient. However, at high concurrency, RTDBC works better and gives more predictable results. So, and even when using one reactive component like WebFlux instead of WebMVC or RTDBC instead of JDBC, you will see improvement. How does the future look for RTDBC? Well, our next important release is expected in May. It might contain stored procedure support, it might not, but the current version is already quite usable. The number of drivers grows. So Oracle is providing a driver, EB2 is providing a driver. And that also indicates that there's traction. Even the large database vendors, they want to provide drivers for this. And the number of clients is also growing. So for example, Flyway, Liquibase, Micronaut clients are a work in progress. And it also indicates that the community around RTDBC is growing. So it's you're not alone when you implement it. What also helps when taking a look at the future is by looking at what certain people have to say about this, of course. Oracle creates JDBC drivers for the database, and they're going to make use of Project Loom when it's available, but it's currently in early access for JDK 16, so that will take a while. First, they had a competing standard, ADBA, but that has been discontinued. And now they have confirmed to be working on an RTDBC Oracle driver, which also indicates that they have, they take this seriously. One of the things to mind, which already indicated, is that performance characteristics of different reactive driver implementations, different reactive clients might differ. So, for example, if you've seen that RTDBC works best better at high concurrency, the same might not be true when using a Vertex client, but you have to measure it for yourself. For RTDBC, it seems to be the case. And of course, now you want to get started with RTDBC. So first, of course, check the homepage. Spring Data RTDBC is quite mature. Well, it's not as mature as the JDBC standard or anything, but it's quite usable. It's out of snapshots versions. There's also an RTDBC Google group. And one of the nice things of this group is that some of the database vendors also sometimes post questions there, and you can check on the status. And it's an open group. It's if you want to stay up to date on RTDBC, I definitely recommend you take a look. And of course, you can also look at my own measures, the raw results, and the sample code I've used to do these tests. Then I would like to conclude with asking you to please rate my app in the official please rate my talk in the official JFall app. Of course, give a high rating because I hope you liked it. And you can ask me questions after the presentation. And I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maarten, for your presentation. If you'd be so kind to turn on your camera as well, please, for the live Q&A session. That would be amazing. Ah, there you are. Okay, I've got a couple of questions for you, picked some out of the audience. The first one is, will Project Loom not avoid thread blocking for JDBC?
Can everyone hear me?
I can, at least.
Okay? Oh, great. Yeah. Okay. It probably will, but it's still in early access in JDK 16. So until it's available and implemented in JDBC drivers, we won't know for sure. But if it's available, then I will definitely test it, of course, and look at it. Plus, I also want to know.
Awesome. Another question, or more, it was more like a discussion, but I'll ask you anyway. Is it possible to use both Spring Data JPA and Spring Data R2DBC in the same app that you know?
To be honest, I haven't tried yet, but there was also a little discussion in the chat that you will probably encounter some issues. So you might have to do some manual workarounds to avoid any conflicts.
Mm-hmm. And the next question is, did you use some kind of read-only flags with your benchmarking that might have influenced the results?
No, I haven't. And you can also browse the sample code. Maybe I should share a link. It's, I think it's a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Because, one moment. Let's see. Yeah, I have to look. Look up the stuff. Please continue with the questions. And I can,
oh, yeah, sure. I've got one more question for you. Is how does the high concurrency, low concurrency depend on the amount of CPU cores that you've got available?
Okay. I also did some performance tests when varying the number of cores. With one core, I noticed quite different behavior, but everything above one core showed similar behavior. That's why I did not include specific graphs related to the number of cores.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, as I remember correctly, I think increasing the number of cores did not increase the performance as much as increasing the number of cores. So when doubling the number of cores, the performance did not double or anything.
Okay, good to know. One last question popped up. Can R2DBC use execute batch functionality?
I'm unsure about that, to be honest.
That's also an answer. And before we end this Q&A, there was a poll that you would like to share. So you can bring that up to the screen, if you will.
Yeah. I was looking at the link. Let's see the poll. That was... Yeah. So I'm really curious what your thoughts are about RTDBC. Do you think about implementing it? What is keeping you, or why not? So I'm really curious what you think about it.
So if everyone is kind enough to fill out this little poll, and we can discuss, or we can show the results in a minute. No, you missed the option. I'm already using it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. This is the link to my test code, test scripts, and the implementations I used, so you can look at them. Yeah, it's a presentation about reactive relational database connectivity. So if you're implementing relational databases, you're probably using JDBC. But yeah.
Could you bring up the results? By the way, I can't interact with your poll.
Let's see. That's over here. And how do I share these? Share.
Ah, there we go.
Oh, this is updated live.
Oh, it seems like it is. Yes.
Oh, cool. So don't be influenced by looking at the results.
Looks like we've got a somewhat of a clear winner. That they doubting about the maturity of R2DBC. Can imagine.
Yeah, it's I started first playing with R2DBC. I think the end of last year or the start of this year.
Mm-hmm.
And Spring Data R2DBC is already out of the snapshot, so it's actually being released. I would definitely, just try it out and see if messages get lost and those things. Confirm the maturity for yourself. So that's probably a good solution for that.
Okay. Well, while you guys are still filling out the poll, I want to take this moment to thank Maarten, obviously, for your really nice talk about R2TBC. there will be a 10-minute break after this session, and I hope to see you in the next session. Thanks again, Maarten, and see you guys. Thank you.
Thank you.